Hello, this is Jason, and this is number 7. This is about my year I spent living in Maui. Kahului, Maui, to be specific. I hope you're doing well, and I hope you saw the first 6 videos. If not, that's okay. Go check them out sometime if you want. I have broadcasted these on Periscope Live, and I have uploaded the video to YouTube as well. I've also uploaded the audio to my website, jasongastrich.com, so you can check any of those out if you want. There's going to be an archive, hopefully, there forever. So, without further ado, I moved to Maui in March of 2019 and lived there for about a year, and it was exciting and unique. I intended on taking showers at the 24-hour fitness gym in Kahului, so I lived in Kahului. However, when I arrived, they were renovating it. So I had visited Maui in 2016, and I knew what the place was like, and it needed to be renovated, for sure. They had 2 showers, and they had like a pole curtain, a plastic pole curtain, and the spigot like reminded me of something that you would see in a circus, like hosing down an elephant. So fortunately, they had started before I got there, and so I only had to avoid showers for a few days. But I gotta... Whoa! Hold on a sec. Let me fix that. My video just took a header. Yikes. Yikes. That was crazy. All right. That has not happened yet. Let's hope that doesn't happen again. Okay. I'm just gonna keep going. My iPad fell off of the chair there, and so looks like it's all good now. Anyways, I'm gonna continue. So, after they finished it, it was real nice in 24-hour fitness. They renovated the bathrooms, the showers, the men's locker room. And I think they did the women's as well. And what they actually added a 3rd shower to the men's locker room, and it was great. It was more private, and it had like a solid closing glass door. And so I showered there daily. It was just perfect. They closed on the weekends, but I worked around it, because they're one of the low-level active 24-hour fitness gyms that aren't open 24 hours every single day. But be that as it may, it worked out. Now, I slept nights in Maui, and that was my intention all along. And I intended to do that because I knew that there wasn't any nightlife there. You know, it wasn't like Honolulu, where there's all kinds of things open 24 hours and lots of places to go and stuff. Kahului was different, you know, and I knew going in that it would be quieter. You know, there's a lot fewer people there. There are a few things to do, but I came there to write some books, I'll tell you about in a sec, and to enjoy a quieter atmosphere. You know, Honolulu is amazing, but it wears you out after a while, just all the people and everything, and all the tourism. There was a 24-hour IHOP that I was kind of surprised was gone. Several businesses that were there in 2016 disappeared and weren't there anymore in 2019, and that was one of them. So I used to use some Wi-Fi there and charge up late. Couldn't do that anymore. I wrote my 2nd haikus book there, called 102 Haikus in Maui. And I wrote it over about 3 months in various places around the island. You can find that on Amazon if you want. Now, Kahului had most of the things that I enjoyed and needed to live. I bought organic food from down to earth. And they even had electricity and bathrooms and free filtered water. It was a good situation there. Sometimes I quickly dry shaved in the bathroom. Excuse me. I like their loose leaf organic teas, like the rooibos was fantastic. I even bought a bunch of that to take with me when I left. And the hibiscus. I got hooked on that there too. I had never really had hibiscus, maybe once somewhere, but this is my first experience I really recalled enjoying the organic hibiscus, the loose leaf. And it's tart, but it's good for you. I feel a boost when I drink both of those. And the I used to feel even a bigger boost from rooibos. Now I think I might feel a bigger boost from the hibiscus. Whatever's in those teas, I think they're things that I don't normally get in my diet. And they're special antioxidants and things. There's some big names for them. You can look them up if you want. Polyphenols or something, maybe. But I always learn about them and then don't necessarily remember everything that I learn about them because I'm always learning. Not to mention I've been fasting all day today and it's after 2 a.m. here in Hawaii. So I'm just, I typed up a bunch of things that I wanted to say and I'm kind of going off that. So I like the people too that would roll in and out of Down to Earth. They were pretty cool. Pretty down to earth. Haha. I liked how they, you know, they got to know me after a while and they were cool with either just making small talk or hanging out or just giving me some space, you know, depending on how I was feeling. I also visited Whole Foods sometimes. They're in a strip mall about a mile or two away and close to the gym. I bought organic wine there, and they had some good prices on like fruit and pretzels and whole wheat bread. I'm an organic vegetarian, so it's kind of hard to find everything I need to eat, but they had a chunk of it, and along with Wi-Fi, water, and bathrooms. They had no electricity, though. The Kahului Library was a few blocks from there, so I visited sometimes. I like how they have solar panels and let people charge their devices, so it felt good to charge up there. I could also use their Wi-Fi and bathrooms and water. The houseless trifecta. One day I had a little bit of weed in my bag and this mean old security guard threw me out. It was unbelievable. I was just minding my own business like normal, sitting at a table. I didn't talk about weed. I never sold weed. And I guess my bag smelled a little bit like weed, but what she did was she got an employee from the library and walked up to me and didn't ask, didn't give me any options. She just said, your bag smells like marijuana, you need to leave. And I was like, what? And so after that, you know, I only returned to write a complaint letter and drop it off there. I just didn't feel comfortable anymore with them treating me that way. And I figured, you know, if this lady is that stupid to throw somebody out, a houseless person nonetheless, for having medicine in their bag, then there's no telling how stupid she could be. You know, she could actually put everybody's life in danger if that's how dumb she is. And I also wanted to stand up for my friends. The other houseless people that were there, a lot of them like weed and have weed and smoke weed. And so what, none of them can have weed on them? They don't have a home, they don't have a house. I mean, they have a home, the earth is our home. But they don't necessarily have anywhere else to stick it. So, you know, I should have told her to stick it. But, you know, I just couldn't comprehend, you know, I couldn't get over how evil and horrible that was. So I wrote a complaint letter, dropped it off, and they never contacted me, and that was the end of that. Once in a while I visited Wailuku. There was a decent library there and a nice view. It's on a big hill, and the hill is fun to ride or walk down, but not so fun to climb up, especially in the heat or with traffic. The bus goes there, though, and it leaves from the Queen Kahumanu Mall. So I visited the mall once in a while, and that was a cool place to hang out. Maybe I used to be a little bit of a mall monkey when I was a kid. That's what my dad would call me. Because me and my friends would want to be dropped off there and just loiter around the mall as a kid, Parkway Plaza or wherever. Now they had a Starbucks and I got hot water and made organic coffee and tea with it. And they had Wi-Fi, no electricity. Sometimes they had organic dark chocolate peanut butter cups and I'd buy those. And there was some seating inside, so it was pretty chill. And the entire mall had Wi-Fi, so there was an upstairs seating area by the food court, and that was a good place to hang out as well. I could easily spend a couple hours there and not even notice. sadly, I noticed a lot of garbage everywhere around Kahului. It was just, it was an armpit. It was not good. And nobody was cleaning it. You know, eventually I decided to take pictures of it for a gross book that I was hoping to publish and inspire somebody to clean it. Pretty depressing, actually. I was going to take 1,000 pictures of garbage, but I only made it to like 300-400 or something. And then I just stopped. It was like, all right, people are going to get the point. You know, there's a lot of gross garbage. And it made me think that the people's name that was on the garbage should probably have some responsibility for cleaning it, especially like if it's in a parking lot, you know, or within a couple blocks, whether it's McDonald's or Whole Foods or Safeway or whoever it is, Taco Bell, Jack in the Box, you know, all kinds of garbage people were not taking responsibility for, Pepsi cans. So the Alamaha is a street that was particularly dirty and gross and jacked up, the road itself as well. And after I started complaining about it and talking about the book I was going to write, somebody cleaned up about 90% of it. So I was pretty stoked on that, because I walk down that street like every day, usually more than once, unless I like took a different route on purpose or something. But it got really bad when it rained too, because the road was all broken, and when it, you know, there's no sidewalks, and there's no light, and so it was pretty dangerous. Like, I couldn't imagine it being any more dangerous if it was like raining at night, because you'd have to like walk in the middle of the street to, because there are giant puddles on both sides and there's no sidewalks. So fortunately I was safe. I also searched for Amanda Eller. I'm not sure if you heard about her in the news or not, but it did make the national news. And she was a hiker and a Maui resident that lived in the town of Haiku, which was kind of interesting. You know, one reason I went to Maui was to write a book of haikus, like I said. And I did write a few haikus in Haiku, of course. Something I had to do. But on May 8th, Amanda Eller got lost, and the police stopped looking for her. And it really disturbed me that somebody in our community could just go jogging and just disappear. And, you know, I'm self-employed and a writer, and it's not like I got a 9-to-5 job I gotta go to. And so, you know, after a while, I started thinking, I gotta go look for this girl, see what happened to her. I don't want just people to just start disappearing out of the blue, anybody else. But who knows, or maybe there's some maniac out there abducting them. So I went to the Makawao Forest, and I took a lot of pictures. I went down one of the trails, and just no sign of her. I looked everywhere. And so I even created a Wikipedia page for the Makawao Forest, because I wanted to draw attention to it, and I wrote a paragraph about her being missing. And eventually a big search party came, and people combed the forest, and they used an app to figure out, you know, which places they had looked and which places still needed to be searched, so they didn't like double their efforts. And her dad paid for a helicopter, and the helicopter went and they found her. So I think she was missing for about 17 days, and she had fallen down a ravine, and I was so stoked that she was found. And in fact, I was going to go back and look for her the day that she was found. I found that to be pretty interesting. What happened was, I was at a sleep spot sleeping, and some idiots ran into my bike, and my bike smacked me in the head. And so I woke up, and I thought I was being attacked, and I was ready to fight back. And it turned out that some moron, it was, you know, in the middle of the night, I think it was 2 a.m., 2:30 a.m., and I was sleeping in front of the Goodwill there. There was a hedge that kind of protects it, which is nice because it kind of blocks the light and gives you some clean air and some privacy, just a touch. So I was sleeping on the sidewalk there, and some moron on a bike ran into my bike, and it hit me in the head. And so I popped up and called the cops, hit 911, and the cops showed up super fast. like within a minute or two, they were there. It was amazing. And I told them what happened, and one cop went after him, and the other cop took my information and everything. And I was pretty stoked that they were on the case so fast. And I felt safer, you know, just knowing that they knew that I was there. But and another thing that was interesting was I had tweeted Ireland Basinger Baldwin's boyfriend at the time and asked him if he wanted to be a hero, and said that, you know, I was going to go tomorrow to go look for this missing jogger, because they were vacationing in Maui at the time. So I want to say it was a Thursday, and I told him I was going to go the next day, and the next day I didn't go because of that. I postponed it one day because I didn't get a good night's sleep, and she was found. I don't think Baldwin or her boyfriend went, but he could have been a part of the celebration and the search team. Now, shortly after that, I found a better sleep spot. You know, I liked that one because it was kind of halfway in between the storage and the gym. And so I could wake up and go to the gym, take a shower if I wanted, or I could wake up and go to the storage if I wanted. It just gave me a lot of options. But it wasn't optimal though, because cars did drive by quite a bit. Sometimes they're real slow and creepily with the lights on. Sometimes people stood around and smoked. And that one moron I just mentioned, I don't know what his intention was exactly. But so to make a long story longer, I ended up sleeping at this spot right across from a mortuary, which was interesting. And it was just up the street from the storage. And it was perfect. I liked it a lot. Nobody was there. Nobody wanted that spot. I mean, there's a lot of houseless people with spots all over the place, but in that area there wasn't anybody for some reason. And so, you know, I took this corner area, which was great because it was protected from the wind, and it was kind of hard. It was a nice, hard, like, I don't want to say it was lava rock, but it was, usually, if there's dirt, I think it's a thin layer of dirt that's over lava rock. But asphalt, you want to sleep on asphalt, it's super hard. Concrete isn't too bad. Dirt or something like that is better. And it was interesting because when I first started sleeping on it, it was real firm. But then after it started raining, it got real nice and cushy. It was like changing the sleep number on my bed. And some grass even grew up under there. So it worked out well. And the mortuary was right in the eye shot. And if it rained, I could just run over to the mortuary and it was covered. And the cops, the security guard and the cops were cool there. And if it rained, they didn't mind if I crashed over there. But if it wasn't raining, they would kick me out. And they're real nice about it too, you know, and I understood, you know, it's private property. It's, you know, it's not, if they want to enforce private property law, and they can do it. And if it's not raining, I don't mind sleeping out under the stars, I'd be happy to. And so, and another good thing was I knew where the camera was at that mortuary. So I knew if I was ever attacked, I could lure the attacker in front of the camera, and the camera would get him on film, and then the cops would be able to find him. Now, I saw a lot of critters in Maui, like toads and birds and turtles and fish. In fact, there was a canal I walked by because it was a shortcut from my gym to town, and I noticed a couple of interesting turtles and lots of fish in it. I think somebody must have tossed them in there because how else would they get in there? And the fish looked like they were cichlids, but there were a couple of different types of fish. Now, Tulsi Gabbard is the representative in Congress for Maui. I think she's also the rep for Kauai and also part of Oahu. I'm certain of it, actually, because I've lived in three of her, I guess it's one district, but three islands that she is the representative of, believe it or not. Isn't that wild? And so we followed each other on Twitter, and you know, I was a big fan of hers for a while, but just seeing Maui look so dirty and gross and not improving, I just totally lost faith in her, you know. And I just, not only did I think she was incapable of being president, but I thought she was also incapable of being the representative, you know. But in her defense, you know, it's, there's like 300 miles from there to Kauai. So, I mean, if you think about a 300-mile gap in, you know, which other congressional districts do that? Like, you know what I mean? Say Southern California, that would be like saying that, having the same representative for San Diego and like above Los Angeles. You just don't do that, you know, it's too wide of a gap and it's separated by an ocean. You know, so she's a representative on three different islands. So I think maybe each island should have their own representative. It would make more sense that way. Now I use Maui Pack and Ship for my mail. They're in Kahului and they're real cool. $5 to get a package or a letter, and they would typically call me when something arrived. And they could put your name on the list if you want to get a package or something for them, so they'll be waiting for it. You can do the same thing at the UPS stores as well. Sometimes I took a bus to Kihei and saw the sunset. It was beautiful. And we scattered my mom's ashes in 2017 off of Wailea, and that's right next to Kihei, and you could see it from there. So it kind of made me emotional and stuff, and I could see where it was from Kihei. But it made me remember my mom. I wrote some poems about it and stuff. And they also have Hawaiian Moon's health food store, which is really good. I bought organic food from there. Now, I biked part of the time I was there, and I walked part of the time. I had envisioned returning to Maui and biking around, so that's what I did. I bought two bikes while I was there, and I think both of them lasted me maybe 6 months total, roughly. And then I walked for the last few months, last 3 or 4 months. But it was good. I think my walking muscles in my legs had atrophied a little because I've ridden the bike so much everywhere. And I wanted to get my legs back, and because I knew I was going to move to Kauai, and I wanted to walk around Kauai, and so it worked out real well. I started doing a unique fast on October 1st, and I did it twice while I was in Maui because it worked so well. I did a 40-day fast without food in 80 days, so I ate every other day for 80 days, and I lost some fat, and I got control of my diet, and it was awesome. In fact, I'm doing one right now. I started doing another one at the beginning of this month, on April 1st. It's my third one of this kind, intermittent fasting is what you could call it. I realized for me, and doing an intermittent fast where I just skipped a meal or two wasn't going to work, because I know me, and I like to eat, and if I did it that way, I would just pound all the calories, either, you know, at the beginning of the day or the end of the day or both, and it really wouldn't do me any good. And so it would be a total stupid exercise. It would just be an exercise in wits or willpower or something. And I wanted more than that. You know, I wanted to lose fat and get toned. And so I started this type of intermittent fasting that works great for me. So this month I have eaten for about 2 weeks and not eaten for about 2 weeks. But I haven't got as much exercise because in 2020 we had to start dealing with the COVID-19 ordeal. Now I call it a pandemic or a scare. I actually called it a pandemic on YouTube the day before the World Health Organization started calling it one, because I looked up the word pandemic and realized that's what it was. It started out like nothing serious, you know, when I was living in Maui, and people didn't change much, and we figured it wouldn't hit us, or at least not in a noticeable way. We were isolated, you know, in the middle of the Pacific. There's pretty much no other more isolated place on the planet, or at least in the United States, than Hawaii. It's really in the middle of nowhere. realized all along that it wasn't as serious as people were acting. And I kept comparing it to the seasonal flu. And I don't know where you stand on it or what you think. I don't really care. You know, because I've done a lot of research, seen a lot of news, read a lot of articles. And every single day I do. And I've had to tune out some news sources because they clearly have an agenda. And they're trying to hammer home on certain points and control people. And I'm not going to be controlled. And I'm not going to believe lies. I'm going to get the information from enough independent sources that I can make conclusions based on the facts, not on what they want me to think or believe. So stores that I visited, like Down to Earth, started closing their seating areas, so I couldn't use their Wi-Fi anymore or charge my devices. Like the storage facility closed their restroom and so did McDonald's. You know, it made me realize that the houseless people were going to have to use far fewer bathrooms, and that was going to cause a concentration of germs in those locations, and that's not good. Eventually, the strip mall removed all the benches and the chairs. It's called Maui Mall. They even removed furniture that I thought was like bolted to the ground that they couldn't remove, and they even removed the bench I was sitting in when I was sitting in it. Yeah. Blew me away. You know, and I didn't put up a fight. You know, I knew that fighting those guys would have been stupid because they were just following orders. You know, the governor has been making orders, the mayor has been making orders, and their bosses, you know, obviously told them what to do. So I don't like fighting people that aren't decision makers. You know, that's pointless and a waste of my time. If I wanted to fight them, I would have asked for the boss. But, you know, it's hard to fight Hawaiian people sometimes because they're so nice, they're so friendly. And even when I make a righteous judgment on their behavior, they usually don't say a word, and they'll just look at me. And so it's kind of like shooting fish in a barrel. You know, if I was making righteous judgments for any other reason besides trying to do what's best for me and everybody and all life on earth, I couldn't do it. I couldn't do it here. And they probably wouldn't want me to do it or let me do it. But when I say what I have to say, it resonates because it's the truth and it's going to benefit everybody and everything. I started getting water from the water store on Alamaha, and it was so good. I recommend it, and I didn't mind paying for a gallon of water in front of the store, but if you went into the store during business hours, they would give you free water if you filled up containers that are less than a gallon. And so I had a refillable Brita water filter bottle I would fill up, and like a metal coffee thermos, and I would stick a bunch of great water in those, especially good when I was fasting. And right before I left, my dad put me up for a few nights at the Maui Seaside Hotel, and it was nice. It was tough to find what I needed on the street at that point, you know? Just the bathrooms and the water and the showers, they were gone, you know? The gym closed up. There we go. Thank you for your patience. So, this kid, I won't say his name, he was not willing to drive to meet me, so I had to grab my bike there or take a bus there, and so it was always an ordeal, you know. And I didn't have a phone plan, like I don't have a phone plan now, so you know, buses are unpredictable, they come late sometimes. It was a long bike ride and arduous because I had to go up a hill, and you know, it was pretty rough. You know, people that don't really think about weed and the ramifications of keeping it illegal or making it difficult for medical people to get it or recreationally illegal, you know, whatever. As long as it's not full-blown legal, like it is, say, in California, it's a pain in the ass. And you meet shady people in weird places and spend hours of your time waiting on morons to come through, and it's just, it's not fun. It's a pain in the ass. to get your medicine, you know, think about it. So, you know, if you have a chance to, and I'm going to record a video on marijuana when I'm done recording these 10 videos, because I've learned a lot, and I wrote a grow book that I grew and directed at a medical marijuana collective in California. It's called Growing Great Cannabis. You can see that on Amazon if you want. I learned a lot of things by trial and error, and made a greenhouse, made a grow room, grew outdoors, indoors. So it was an exciting hobby. It was a lot of work. And don't think you're going to do it and get rich, because it's not a real big money-making thing. Unless you got a gigantic investment in a huge, huge facility or something. And that was never the goal. But I'll explain all that on that video. So just be sensitive to the situation, because some people like me, I take zero pills every day. You know, I think if I have to rely on a pill, then I made some horrible mistakes in my life. And I am an organic vegetarian, I take care of my body. I know that pills all have side effects and cause degenerative diseases, and I'm not taking them. And so, you know, the doctor prescribed 750 milligrams of hydrocodone for the pinched nerve in my back, and it just made me a zombie. I sat there and just stared at the wall all day. I did not get anything done. I hated it, so I didn't even finish the bottle. And I got a marijuana recommendation from several doctors in California for several years. And that medicine worked better. It helped me manage the pain. And I was so active too, unbelievably active. I would exercise, I would spend time with my family, I would work, I was teaching music lessons. And so, you know, it was like a performance-enhancing drug if you teach music lessons or if you're a musician. So, I mean, it may not be the best thing, like if you're operating heavy machinery or something, but that's not my job. And so, you know, not one size doesn't fit all. And making it illegal for everybody, when some people seriously need it, is not right. So, I was talking about the hotel that I stayed in, the Seaside Hotel there, which was awesome. It had a nice view. And they closed it, though. They closed it before they were ordered to close it, just because they weren't getting any business. So the day I checked out, it was only going to stay open maybe one or two more days. But I was flying out. See, I had planned all along to move to Kauai to write my third book of haikus. And I was going to move to Kauai in December. And then I decided, you know, that's the rainy season. And Kauai is the garden isle. And it gets tons of rain. So I said, okay, let me postpone it until for like 3 months, till the end of March. And then maybe, you know, I won't get caught in the rain as much, and it'll be smarter to go then. So when I left on March 28th to come to Hawaii, it was interesting timing, because this whole COVID-19 thing was starting to get worse, and they were starting to, the governors and the mayors were starting to issue all kinds of orders. And in fact, just a few days after I got to Kauai, the governor issued a 14-day quarantine order. First it was just to mainland travel, but then they said air island travel as well. So anybody coming to the islands were required to be quarantined somewhere for 14 days. And you actually had to show them proof, like at the airport, of where you're going to stay. And, you know, houseless people don't exactly have proof of where they're going to stay. Yeah, outside somewhere. So, you know, I had a storage unit lined up, but I didn't have everything else lined up. But it worked out well. Now, I used a camp shower for the last few days that I was in Maui. I'd never used a camp shower before. I thought about it many times. But the Jack in the Box in Kahului had a spigot with good water. I always smell water before I drink it, and I encourage you to too. Because sometimes it smells like metal and you don't want to drink it. And this didn't smell like metal. And so I actually drank it. I put it in my Brita water filter bottle, and I drank it, and I showered with it there. The camp shower was great because there was an a spigot, like I said, but then there's also an eyelet, and it was right next to it, and it was a real strong beam. Like, it couldn't have been any better planned. And it was in this little spot in front of the store where people used to hang out sometimes. Homeless people would sleep there, or houseless people, I mean, would sleep there, or smoke cigarettes there, God forbid. So they didn't bug me the first, I think I did it three times. And two or three times. The first time or two, they didn't bug me, and it was pretty early in the morning. And then the last time, they told me to get out of there. And I said, fine. I said, this is the last time you'll ever see me. Because it was literally, I was flying out of Maui that same day. I almost didn't shower, but I had spare time. And I wasn't sure where I was going to shower next in Maui. Because I knew they closed the gyms, but at the time, the YMCA stayed open. See, I think they were only under an order from the mayor at the time to close the gym in Maui. And they weren't under an order yet from the governor to close the gyms on all the islands. And the YMCA is actually a charitable organization. So my plan was to go to the YMCA and shower there daily. And I thought they would probably keep it open because it was a charitable organization, even if they were ordered to be closed. And I was wrong on both accounts. Apparently that one was not allowed to stay open, and they were ordered to close. So fortunately, my dad was really nice and said he wanted to put me up in a place. And so I stayed in a hotel for a couple of days in Kahului, and then a condo in Kapa'a. But that's for next time. Now, just to be clear, I never showered at that naked. You know, I didn't think that was appropriate. I showered in my boxer shorts in front of a jacket box, and I soaked up and used a natural sponge and organic soap. And so I was very good and clean and nice and normal. And I respected the wishes. You know, they're a business. They can make the rules. They can do what they want. And the cops didn't even show up. But I hurried that shower and got the heck out of there. I didn't want to stick around and find out. Imagine getting arrested and thrown in jail on your last day and onto the island when you're supposed to be flying out. That would be horrible. Now, one more thing. I wrote a book in Maui called A Brand New World, How It All Ends. It was the 10th book, and it was going to be the final book in my Brand New World series, which is a pretty interesting series and unique. I encourage you to check it out. It's on Amazon. And I figured it would be my last book, but nonetheless, I was still writing story ideas in case I decided to write an 11th book, another one. And then eventually I did decide to write an 11th book, and I took a few months off, or I took a while off, I don't know how long, and I started the 11th book, which I've called A Brand New World, The Addendum, in Kauai, and it's been exciting. I've written a bunch of stories for it. You can see those on my website. The way I do it is I write the story, and then I upload it to my website. And I write all the stories in the book and post them on my website. And then when I'm done writing the book, I'll take them all down and then publish them. So, I'm not a writer to make money. I'm a writer because I like to write. It's fun, it's exciting. It's a journal of sorts, the poems and the stories. And this particular book, How It All Ends, that I wrote in Maui, kind of put together the beginning and the end of my writing styles for the 10-book series. What I mean by that is, remember I started this series when I was studying journalism in 2012 in Long Beach. And so they were about news stories. And all of them were like one-offs. You know, there's no continuity whatsoever. And so the last three books had a character I introduced named Rico. And it followed him around. And he ended up going to Hawaii as well. And one thing led to another. He was waiting for some money to be released, and he started living on the street, kind of like I was. And he was trying to cross Derry Road, going over to Down to Earth, and he was hit by a vehicle, and he spent the whole book inside of Maui Memorial Hospital. And so the interesting thing, though, was while he was in the hospital, he was watching the news. So I got to develop his character and the stories while I was writing stories about news stories. So I got to put those two things together. It was an exciting evolution of my writing and writing style. He was in his hospital bed watching the news. And apparently, after I left, Maui Memorial Hospital was severely hit with the 2019 novel coronavirus. Dozens of people were diagnosed with the virus, over a dozen health care workers at the hospital. And I just read an article, and you can see it online. They think 56 people from the hospital probably had it or have it, including 36 staff members and 20 patients. So I hope they're okay. Now, my next broadcast is going to be on Kauai. I'll cover everything that is related to Kauai, the COVID-19, the haikus, kapa'a, the hui, the health food stores, the Y, the Walmart, the stimulus, the UI, the bus issues, hotels, condos, and the other towns and things here. I'm going to bring you to Kauai and show you how to live here and explain what it's all about. Just like I've been doing for story or broadcast number 8. Thank you for listening. I wish you the best. Good luck. Shoots. That's in 2 days from now on broadcast.com.
May 1st.